involve a man with, so you can lay them down anywhere you can find a spot. It's loose in our hands, but I understand you've been getting different variations of this all the way through. I realize this is kind of a dangerous thing for an instructor to do after lunch and in the heat of the afternoon, just get everybody laid back, but here goes. I find this helps a lot, stay loose, especially before going on stage. I do this anytime I get ready to play. It kind of has the effect of making your hands feel like you've been playing for a couple hours already. First step, just grab your finger right up here and just squeeze it. Just all the way around. It's not a prescribed amount of pressure, just what feels good to you. You do that, go up to the next one. This makes four times that night just for the last 2 days. My hands are feeling pretty damn good. I found out this morning, go out to your tip. Yeah. You can do eagles or whatever you want. I found out this morning that this has closely akin to reflexology. Go to the next finger, do the same thing. And the reason that it feels good is because I'm massaging all of my organs,
right.
My brain, and everything else while I'm doing it. I don't understand why it feels so good.
You should just rub your ear instead of your hand.
So it's an extra added bonus. When the first day I showed this, the first comment about this was, oh, I could do this before I got out my Playboy. And I went, well, I don't think any of us needed to know that.
Lord.
Yeah.
Doing it wrong.
Right, be serious, man. Come on. Help me out here.
Close your ears, baby.
This is my last class. I'm just sitting about piled up against the wall on this one. When y'all are advanced, you should know better. Okay, next time. Okay. Yeah. Two hands.
Good. Right and left. I'm advanced,
yeah. Yeah, you know you've got two hands. Oh yeah, I'm supposed to say that Randy Wood still wills Madden's. First Madden I played on that was in camp was a 2-point Randy Wood. I wish I still had access to it. Okay. Yeah, it's about my ears when people start getting quiet. Okay, next step. Grab it right here and just pull it. Just pull blood into the end of it. Just do them all. At your own tempo. Shape and a haircut for that story. And variations thereupon. That's a minor haircut. That's shaving a minor haircut is what I generally get.
True.
Okay, see, what the secret of this is really what this does is relaxes me enough to stand up in front of people and talk. Okay, next up. In between the tendons here on the back. Smash down a little bit, rub it.
thing kind of like once a day, or do you do like, you do it in the morning, practice for a couple of hours, and then like a time later, you do it again? Or you kind of?
I generally do it anymore. I kind of do it just every day until it feels good, and I can ask for a loose.
Yeah.
I just don't feel the same.
But if you stop back for 2 or 3 hours, you don't really feel
it. I don't go do it again. No. All right. Palm. Stretch this way. Just overlap them. Go across. Take a little extra time on the meaty parts. Alright. And there's all types of this to do. I see people doing it. Walking around backstage, doing all kinds of odd little exercises to loosen up. It's not only does it help your hand, but it kind of has a calming effect. It's a little psychological thing, like, okay, I can do this. You know, time to stop, breathe, and think about what you're fixing to do. Okay, have to do that. Bend them back. Snap them off, just snug them up. Might hear some popping, that's all right. I'm going to hit a little bit on technique as far as Monroe's style. This is the advanced class. Okay, well, I've stumbled into a private moment here. Sorry. Okay. Excuse me. All right. This works good. This is the quickest one. That's the best. You can do this on stage, which I do. So you get in something that's a fast tempo and you have a tendency to get all wound up and nervous toward the end of it. It's like pushing your hands flat up against the wall. Just pull it out, hold your fingers and just push it out straight. But it gets my forearm real loose. Like that. Hi. That looks funny, doesn't it? What's he got there doing in there? Get playing and get really tensed up like this. That seemed like just doing that a couple times like that and pull it all out of you. Okay, that's pretty much it.
I'm going to talk a little bit about technique. I'm going to say, y'all are all probably listening to people play. You've got favorites, I suspect. I'm going to show you some Monroe style technique anyway.
Let's give this a chance. All of my song and dance about being serious and being individuals and so on and so forth, it's probably more wasted on you than it would be a beginner class. I would stress it to be serious. Okay. I would stress it to be serious about it. This is a language. Just learning the language. The technical aspect of it obviously is the major barrier in between us being able to feel something and express it. I find myself still overlearning the technique. I never quite get it. That's the weird shades of it where I kind of get it and don't get it. This was Monroe's way of expressing himself. It's not good one-on-one. You could get up in front of lots of people and say that he felt good or he felt bad. He could do it that way. And this is his way of expressing his feelings. He was highly competitive to a fault. And was kind.
Oh.
All right. That's my wife checking on me. Where was I? Sonny Osmer said that whenever he was working with Monroe, because he was a young kid, was therefore highly impressionable, that everything Bill did was like a contest to him. He wants to see how long it would take him to overcome whatever the obstacle was. And he said he played the man with him like it was punishment, that he just beat it. It was to show this, that he was the boss, not it. I'm thinking sometimes the reason, especially really young kids, seems like they just play circles around a lot of folks. I don't think they make it hard. They don't know how hard it is, so it's not. If that makes any sense. Monroe picked all this up for determination. He was the youngest child. He wanted to be a fiddler, and was a fiddler, basically. He called like a fiddler, he just played mandolin. They made him take four strings off the mandolin when he was a little kid, so they wouldn't get in the way of the real musicians in the family. And he set out finding the way that he could make the most noise on this little instrument. So he got a lot of bang for his buck that way. Okay, I'll show you some of that as we go along. I know there's some questions, some specific things that some of you were asking about. Help me remember those. We talked about it some at lunch. I don't have it all written down. So we'll cover whatever it is you want to cover after I get through running my mouth.
Okay.
Well,
I'm going to lot of people talking about what's right or wrong. There really is no right or wrong. What sounds good to you and feels good to you is your ear's the final judge. And you can play this style. All of you can play this style. It would still all sound different, so we'd all pick up on just parts of it. So you can do that. I'm going to show you some right-hand grip. Like I say, you've all probably settled in on something at this point, but this is Monroe. So let's do this. I'm going to do the ink pen trick. I saw this somewhere in elementary school where they make this look like a piece of rubber.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, y'all don't have to do it. This is just the illustration. So it looks like rubber. It's an illusion. That's where your pick ought to be working. It's almost that loose. The stop grip. I guess somebody passed out songbooks somewhere along the line at the Opry, because all the old Opry shots, you see their hands are like this. Is this joint your favorite?
Okay,
this is your second one. Okay. This joint your favorite? Ball of your thumb. And what do you do? You cross them. I said, lots of different grips I've seen the last couple of days. This grip right here probably is one of the most versatile. And once you get used to it, you get a lot of control. You got a lot of power out of it. Put your pick in there like this. Just lay it in there and cross your, these two joints in your finger over, so it can move. And I'm talking about sticking a lot of it out. I mean, some of you that use a smaller pick, but it would vary.
So basically,
your pick works like I showed you with the ink pen. Now this is an exaggeration. Keep that in mind. But basically, it looks like that when it's working. All right, can any of you see that back there closer to the back? It's basically that. This is a fulcrum. That's how you use it. It's not about strength. It's about having a point.
right there. It's a little bit hard to get used to, but once you get used to it, it's real comfortable, it works real well, you can stay a lot more relaxed like this. And it's not as damaging to your muscles and your joints. A little bit more volume. The way to get it with this grip, I find you can mash down on your thumb just to get a little bit firmer grip. And also, it involves, if you want to really dig in on something, I noticed that Mill would turn his hand this way a little bit. Just slightly that way. And it just gives you a little bit different point of attack. Okay? The way you use this is flat across the strings, not at an angle. This way or that. Some people prefer to use it that way. I find you get a lot fatter tone if you play it flat across, like that. Just right flat on the string. Now, it slides across the string easier, granted, if you're at a slight angle, but that's because you don't have as much pick material going across the string. Okay? Got a question? Okay. You get a lot? All right, let me see.
Get ahead of myself. Okay. I don't stay on this too long. I've got a lot of things to do.
You get a fatter note or something like that. Now, I know a lot of people are starting to buy it. They say the Grisman don't engage like that one. It's got a rounded edge on it. I really prefer them that way, but I've got a bunch of these new, so I have to try to wear them down. But what
you get that point, you don't have as much plastic going across, you don't get as fat at all.
Tone is there's an infinite variety of tone in between pitch pressure, type of pitch material, playing anywhere from the bridge up to about, say, here. We play gospel turnarounds. This is nice. Sounds kind of like church bells, I guess. As opposed to on the other end of the spectrum. Gritty, quite abrupt, a little mean sounding. This place for all of them. I think it's wise to think about whenever you're playing something, what's it about? What's the tune about? A related story, some of you that's been in here have heard me talk about this. It makes a big deal of difference when you're playing a tune to think about what the song, what the tune is about. Just playing through a series of notes is fine and good, but whenever I hear somebody playing it that's obviously thinking about what the piece of music is about, it does make a difference in the way it sounds. It makes a difference in, I think, how the listeners are perceiving it. It starts to paint pictures in your head about it. I mean, let's face it, if we're not selling what we're doing to the people that are listening, we really haven't got the point across. This helps get the point across more. Just paint a picture with it. Think about it. The story that I've been using, it's a violin player. She learned a piece of music. She went up in front of her master teacher and played it. He said, "That's great, but what it's about?" I said, what do you mean, what's it about? I said, "Well, a piece of music was about a river." He said, "What color is the water? How deep is it? Is it cold water? Is it warm water? Is it running fast? Is it running slow? Is the sun shining? Is the wind blowing? What's it about?" It's just something to think about. When you get all of that in there, it starts to paint pictures, and you can use your tone to change all that. I mean, licks are fine, but I think probably if you're not saying anything, it's kind of pointless. I don't mean just to be fanatical until you're taking all the fun out of it, but it does help. It does sound different. And you've got a little thought involved in it when you play it for people. Okay? Now get on with that.
Rhythms. Something else to think about.
You're playing something like when I used this morning, it was Blue Night. It's a blues. Kind of a jump blues. It's about a guy who's lost his girlfriend. She won't talk to him anymore. Won't even answer the phone. He don't know why. This is not what I would think you would put in a breakdown tempo.
Yeah.
you go across the stream, turn around and go the other way. So you don't get this sound. We're trying to get a long sustained note. Okay? So work at trying to get this thing, as soon as it gets on the other side of that string, come back. It's almost like keeping the pick in contact with the string all the time. Does that sound any different? Okay. See what I'm getting at. May even be helpful to do. We're going a circular motion this way with your wrist and play it with chop and what have you, which we'll get to later. Sometimes it's helpful to go this way. Slightly. In a circle going this way. Okay? Not squares, triangles, circles. All right. Okay. Other kinds of tremolos. This is what I call the Irish washerwoman style tremolo. I think this is one that kind of sunk in.
Thank you.
real slow instead of real fast. Okay. Well, I was glad to find that. All right. There's another type of trim law. There's all kinds of triplets that I can show you. Another type of tremolo that's used, I want you to play along on this. Let's see if I'm going back to Old Kentucky in A.
If you know it by ear, I'll probably say play it. I don't know if this is written out right in here. It involves a push
on the downstroke of the tremolo as opposed to the up. This is not focusing on an even down, up, down, up. It's a little bit more of a push on the downstroke. So what you get instead of this is that's exaggerated a little.
How long are you familiar with going back to Kentucky?
Okay, let me show you first what I'm talking about. What it does, it tends to have a little bit of a forward lean, say. And it matches the banjo roll real good. See, A chord. See the difference in the way it sounds? It took me forever to pick up on that, right? Let's run through that there. Okay. Let's trade on being just a little bit heavier, man. We don't want to go. Okay. Just a little bit heavier on the downstroke. The trick to this is not going to be this hand, but on getting your notes to come in and coincide with where the downstroke is coming in. But that seems to be the hardest part for me anyway. Thank you. wondering what the hell we got into in here. Okay, good. You get the picture. All right.
What's one of the drawbacks, sister? It's
not that you're mad on that team. Okay. I love it. Okay. Let me get some more stuff here. I can show you the basic lick on downstrokes. I mean, it's pretty much, it's not a new approach to mandolin play. Okay? Basically, it's what's the, I said the basic lick on this is what they call a rest stroke, which is you go across the string and rest your pick on the next one. It's just a, kind of a gauge more than anything. Just like that. This is also done with an open hand, open wrist, like this. I'm convinced that the hardest thing to do on a downstroke is to stay relaxed while you're doing it. You have a tendency, especially at higher tempos, to start going like that. And we're talking about much about thinking of a word. My word for downstrokes is relax. The whole time I'm doing it. So relax, come on, relax, relax. You want to get behind, relax, relax. And you can play any kind of melody with a downstroke. Monroe's approach is generally a blues-oriented style of thing. It's a very old technique. You can play scales with it. This is because a downstroke, you get the most tone for a stroke out of the two. You've got down and up. Down is a lot stronger than up for some reason. It must be some physical kind of thing, but this is a lot stronger than it. It's really hard to get them even. So, the downstroke, it's got a lot more power in it. If you want to do that, I mean, you can play any kind of thing. It's not necessarily just a kind of a honky-tonk thing. It could be...
Works like this. Thank you.
starts over and over again. Okay. To the first part, first section. Then next part. Keep the tremolo going. It's not going to come out right anyways. Okay, 1, 2, 3, and... Okay. Do anything. good to have, like some of the R&B records, we have the lead going, you play the lead an octave below. That's like...
Methodist preacher and after Old Mountaineer. Mostly all all double stop chords all the way through. We're starting at a G chord, working through a C, a G7, a C, back to G. So we're going like this.
Blues. This guy's by himself.
famous, the same as one you've already got. Already learned that part.
Okay.
Let's just do the whole thing.
Okay.
Got it. All right. understand the question. Okay, I asked it, but I didn't understand what I was asking. Okay, the question is, I'm talking about playing out of a position. The one in question is a double stop A that you do 6th and 7th fret. This A chord. 6th fret on the G string, 7th fret on the D string. Is that right? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. All right, that's an A. That's another one that you can walk up to out of this one, by the way. Okay? This is one of Monroe's favorite pastimes. This is like something to do on the bus. I used to have a roommate that played with him a while. He said that he'd do this for hours and hours and hours, just riding on the road looking out the window. All right. This works real good on simple tunes. It's surprising how much you can get out of this, just locked into this chord. It's going to be something like Sally Gooden. Okay.
Insinuate it, you do it out of this right here. You're basically saying
Jim, since you're running up here, you're going to have to deaden one string, which is D. When you do that, lift immediately a little better. Fret, G, string.
Thank you.
actually a better, I don't know if it's in here or not, but that's actually a better one to go to because it's mainly good. If I'm thinking that's new, it may not be easier.
I'm sure it'd be easier than that. I don't think so.
Okay, it's not.
That's a good one because one whole section of it is nothing but octaves and unisons. It's very typical phrases in this that were used late 70s, early 80s, late 80s, early 90s in Monroe. I'm doing a scramble tomorrow if anybody's interested in tunes like Old Andy Peel, Old Andy Scrooge, Old Mountaineer, Lonesome Moonlight Waltz, Old Lonesome Waltz. It's all tunes from around the same time period, and they've all either got the word old or lonesome in the title. There's a lot of standard lifts, okay?
Old Andy Peel.
If you're interested in this style, there's that chord again, okay? This is a real common place for Monroe to be playing in his last years. It was right in here, in between the second and the fifth fret. And out of A, he loved playing A. A minor. So like, up until the last few years of his life, he played in a lot in A, and then he started playing in E minor for some reason. Everything he's playing in an E minor. But go back to A and Old Andy Peel. Open. Or if you choose, a unit. Grandmom. Yes, sir.
Well, you're playing, is your pop such as original? Or you
no.
Repeat that question. Repeat.
Yeah, I will. Whenever I'm playing, does my palm touch the bridge? Now and then, but it's no rest, not resting on it. You see, the guys that make these mandolins spend lots of time trying to figure out how to make a good sounding mandolin. And we spend lots of time killing the tone. You don't want to put your hand on the bridge. Leastways not for this approach. I've had standing spouting off and I've had people say, well, so-and-so said you can do it this way. Well, it's obviously a matter of personal preference. I'm sure you're aware of that at this point in the game. But to get the optimum volume and tone out of this, you don't want to be, especially not the bridge, anything else. Anchoring your fingers is not quite as bad, but I mean that restricts your right hand. The sole purpose of this is just to make the top vibrate. If you touch your hand on that, you're restricting the instrument's ability to do that. But I'm going to make this hole back here. Just make the rest of my forearm on the edge. If I'd be able to play in the hole, everything would be swinging out here. I'll see how, It's just left hand and a strap, and that's about it. Okay? As you can see, there has been some rambunctious playing here. Pick guard doesn't hurt, especially one like this, which is small and doesn't cover up any of the sound hole. I think some people dislike it. I was surprised it didn't really make any difference once I got one. When you've got your fingers up, that pretty much is not going to be involved there anyway. Do scratch it from time to time, it's mostly pick. Let's see if I can get something else along here. I've forgotten anything. Any more questions about what's happening so far?
Thank you.
I've been asked to do this, which is shameless self-indulgence, but was asked. Big bits and pieces of Monroe tunes. I put parts of Dusty Miller, Lockwood, old Ebenezer Scrooge. It's not in there. I don't have it copyrighted yet, so it's not in the book. There's about five or six different tunes in my father's footsteps. This is all Monroe stuff. If you're familiar with some of those tunes, you can hear them going by. This is called William Smith. Let's see how it goes.
Okay. Dan just is about having fun. kind of rhythmic drive do you have in all that? A lot of people miss the it's playing da 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 da, but there's something else going on there.
Rhythmic drive in all that.
Rather than just straight da 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 da.
There's any number of syncopated rhythmic things that you can do. It's not in there. There's any number of syncopated things you can do. Here's a few examples. Listen up.
Morning or afternoon, see you at the show.